I just want to tell you what the Lord is saying. What the Lord is saying right now is, Hi ladies, today's podcast is all about how to know God speaking to you. And I know that was a little bit funny, but one sure way to know that God isn't speaking to you is that you hear nothing. When you say, and it was actually Shiki that said this, she said, sometimes when you say, the Lord said, and then you hear nothing, it's probably because he didn't say anything. And the Bible says, don't say he said if he didn't say. So if you're interested in knowing whether it's your own mind, the voice of somebody else, or the voice of God, you're gonna love this PG podcast. If you grew up in a preacher circle, or if you grew up in church, then you've heard the term, the Lord said 100 times. In fact, preachers say it all the time. And the Lord said, and the Lord said, and the Lord said. And you're wondering, if God's doing all this talking, why am I not hearing anything? Why is he not talking to me? So I want to help you preacher girls get to the point where you can hear the voice of God, identify the voice of God, and know that it is him who is talking to you. So the first step to making sure you know and recognize the voice of God is to quiet your mind. So here's the trivia question. Where is the noisiest place on earth? If you answered your mind, you're probably right. Every day, every second, 1,000 thoughts rush their way through our minds, and it is a loud noise between our ears. I've firmly believed all my life that one of the biggest problems in Christianity and with people who call themselves believers is that we can't shut up long enough to listen to God. I'll say it again in a different way. Sometimes our mind is talking so loud, so much, there's so much going on between our ears that we cannot hear the voice of God. So what I do is I actively practice listening for and not just listening to the voice of God. First of all, how do you do that? You find a spot where you can be alone with God. No praise and worship music, no ambient noise, no bubbling brooks, just you and God. To be able to hear his voice, not the voice of nature, not the voice of family, just him, then the very first person that you need to quiet down is yourself. So find a quiet spot and just be silent. Quieting your mind is a process. What I've found with myself, it's not so easy, especially when there's a lot going on. So I literally count backwards from 20, very slowly, and focus on nothing except the numbers, 20, 19, 18. And as other thoughts try to bombard your mind and try to come in there, actively push them out. Like the Bible says, take those thoughts into captivity and cast them down. And when you get to one, just stay quiet for a little bit. I know it reminds you maybe of Eastern meditation, but it's not that. It's the preparation of your mind to be able to hear the voice of God. If it helps you, then meditate on one scripture. Take one that you're familiar with, Genesis 1 and 1, John 3:16, John 1 and 1, Hebrews 11 and 1, Romans 6 and 23. All of these very familiar scriptures are great ways to just begin to quiet your mind and just get to the place where you say, Lord, I am available. I am ready to hear from you. Now speak. And then the second sure way to be sure that it's God that's talking, or to recognize his voice, is to know where he's speaking from. That's so important, because many of us count every single person that speaks to us as the voice of God. Just because somebody says, the Lord told me something to tell you, just because you turn on the TV and there's a preacher, just because you're listening to a worship song that says, you know, this is the scripture or whatever, it doesn't necessarily mean that in that instance and context, God is speaking to you. It is important to know where God is speaking from, not only what God is saying. Let me show you what that looks like. So I'm in this room right now. Have you ever, like, somebody's talking to you and you look the other way? Because it sounded like their voice was coming from over there. Usually, if you're in a room that has very non-absorbent walls, non-porous walls, the sound bounces back at you like an echo. So you are not sure where the direction is coming from. Sometimes in our lives, because of a situation, something big in the way of our lives, when the Lord speaks to us, it bounces off. You know what? Some of us are bouncing our God's voice off media. We're bouncing God's voice off of some sitcom. We're bouncing God's voice off of a show that we're into right now. So we put on the lenses of whatever it is that's consuming us, whether it's Facebook or Instagram or TikTok or family or friends, and everything God says gets bounced off of that. And it gets looked at through those lenses. Let me tell you something. If you do that, then you are putting God into the limits of what mankind has created, and you can't do that. It can't happen. It's important that you know God's position. Where is He speaking from right now? So for instance, in your life, when you're sitting in church, you know where He's speaking from? The pulpit. You know where He's speaking from right now? This podcast. You know where He's speaking from when you're praying? From heaven, from your spirit. And so what happens is when you try to speak to God and you have someone singing worship in your ear, it may be good in order to get to a place of praise. But when you want to hear Him, you got to turn the music off. When you want to hear Him, you got to turn the TV off, put your cell phone off, and not just on vibrate. Push those things away because those are bouncers. Those things confuse you as to exactly where the voice of God is coming from. Satan is very, very good at mimicking the voice of God. Do you know that? He'll come to Eve and he'll say, "Didn't God say?" And what he does is takes the voice of God and twists it so that you hear something very different. If you get real like into your favorite rom-com or your favorite romantic movie and you're thinking that this guy is going to be perfect, and he comes into your life, somebody comes into your life, Satan sends a man into your life that says exactly the same thing you heard in the movie, you might think it's God. You might think God has finally sent you Mr. Right. Why? Because it's bouncing off the wrong surface. The only surface that God bounces His voice off is the Word of God. If it doesn't line up with the Word, it sure is not God. So be very aware of where His voice is coming from. I'll give you one more example. If you're hearing God's voice from a secular voice, from somebody who does not believe in Christ, for somebody who teaches the opposite of what the Word of God says, it's not God's voice. Because the Bible says that good water, fresh water, can't come from a bitter place. In other words, good and bad can't come from the same resource. So ask yourself, when you think God is speaking, where is that voice coming from? Once when I was 12 years old, I heard the voice of the Lord say that it was time for me to get into active ministry. Who tells that to a 12-year-old? Well, apparently God does. So I remember washing my dad's car one Sunday morning. Yes, I did that every Sunday. It was part of my chores. How did I end up being the one washing the car when I got two brothers? Anyway, I'll talk to my mom about it later. But yes, I ironed all my family's clothes and washed dad's car every Sunday before we went to church. And one day, as I was washing the car, listening to a cassette tape of a preacher that I plugged into the car while I washed the car every Sunday at 12 years old, that was my routine. The voice of the Lord spoke to me, yes, through the preacher, but mostly in my spirit. And he says, "It's time for you to begin your ministry." I didn't know what that meant or what that looked like. So you know what I did? I said, I remember very distinctly the day my godmother said to me, she said, "Sharo, the day God tells you what to do, you answer, 'Yes, Lord.'" Honey, that's the only two words I knew to say. I didn't say, "What does that look like, Lord? Lord, give me five steps." All I said was, yes, Lord. I know the day. I remember the spot under the mango tree where the car was parked. I'll never forget it. But by about an hour later, my mom came and I was in the car weeping in the back seat, tears pouring down my face, speaking in tongues because I said yes and I knew he had called. That was the day I went to church and I started the first ever youth group in my dad's church. That finally, it became Daystar, the youth group that turned into Judah Tribe, that is now Genesis. And that was the day it was born because I knew I was waiting to hear God call. My whole life I had been waiting just for him to give me permission, give me access, and tell me it's time. So what's the third way to hear God's voice? It is an act of active obedience. Just saying, God, the day you tell me, you won't have to give me all the answers. You won't have to give me all the steps. You'll just have to say, now is the time. And what you're going to get from Sharo is a yes, Lord. So I want to tell you, if you want to hear the voice of God, prepare your yes before he speaks. Prepare your yes to whatever he says. Prepare your yes, even if it makes you uncomfortable, even if it's something you don't like to do, like go live or, you know, do FaceTimes. Whatever it is, prepare the yes. So God knows, you know what I have here? Not somebody who is able, not somebody who is capable, just somebody who is willing. And if God finds the person who is willing, then not only will he tell you, I'm ready for you, it's your time, but he will do that continuously through your life because God's not going to tie you and pull you into his will. He's looking for a yes, an obedient and ready yes. The last thing I want to tell you about recognizing the voice of God is this. You've got to practice listening. Practice listening does not mean practice listening to prophets or practice listening to missionaries or practice listening to preachers. When you familiarize yourself with the way I speak, guess whose voice you learn to recognize? Mine. So many preachers out there and young people like you or older people like us or very older people like some of us who want to hear the voice of God, you try to be like another preacher or be like another entrepreneur or be like another woman of God. And all you end up doing is hearing their voice. Familiarizing yourself with the voice of God means you listen for him. I've done it this way. I have journal upon journal upon journal. I've told you this. Every time he says something, I write it down. He said this. He said this. All through my life, he has spoken. And whenever he speaks, I write it down. And you know what ends up happening? I start seeing a pattern to the way he speaks to me. So that by the time I was 21, his voice was as familiar to me as my dad's voice or my mom's voice or a friend's voice because I had been so used to hearing the way he speaks to me. It's very unique and very different, so he doesn't call me twice. He doesn't have to call me twice. Maybe in the beginning, it was Sharo, 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 but now he just has to say, hey, and I'm there because I recognize it. My soul recognizes. And so this is what I want. This is what the book says, the Bible says, when it says that deep cries out to deep. If you keep waiting for him to speak here, you'll never hear him. But the deep things of God cries out to the deep parts of you. How do you find that deep part of you? You know, the part of you that gets so wrecked when somebody hurts your feelings or when you lose someone you love or when somebody really breaks your heart. That part of you, that's a deep place. When God says one word to you, he hits that place without you having to be broken, without you having to be hurt. It's the way that you start crying when you see something that shouldn't make you cry. That is a surefire way to know God is trying to say something. He is trying to reach you in a place where you'll not only be affected in the level of your mind, but your soul and your spirit will also be affected. So that's what I mean when I say learn to practice hearing his voice. If you don't hear his voice every day, if you don't use that ability to hear him, you're going to lose that ability to hear him. You're going to depend on the words of man instead of depending on the words of God. I hope that we get to be a tribe of people, men and women, who get so familiar with his voice that it doesn't matter where we are and what the world is saying and what we hear in the media and what we hear from the government, even what we hear from the pulpits, because we are so familiar with his voice. You know, in Israel, shepherds don't tag sheep. Shepherds don't tag their sheep. They just go, or they say, or they make a really weird sound. Yeah, we're like, yeah, I mean, it's embarrassing sometimes. But the sheep are so familiar with their shepherd's tone that they'll leave wherever they are and come. The sheep are very familiar with only his voice. You know what Jesus said? He said, you'll know my sheep because my sheep know my voice. What does that mean if you do not know his voice? So it really means that we all have to take the time to become familiar. Not with Hillsong, not with Bethel. They hear God's voice for themselves. But do you hear God's voice for yourself? Here's a tip. If you hear God speaking, but you're not sure, you're thinking, okay, is that me or is that him? One of my favorite preachers said this just the other day, and it stuck in my spirit. She said, if you hear God's voice and you're not sure it's him, obey anyway. Say, Lord, I'm not sure this is you, but I'm going to do this. Because if it's not him, he'll stop you before you get there. And that is such good advice. If he says do, say, think, go, then you prepare yourself immediately to go, just as an act of ultimate obedience. And if it's not him, he'll put all the blocks in front of you. Well, preacher girls, I hope that this made sense to you. I hope that it helps draw you into an intimacy with Jesus, where you love his voice more than any voice on the planet. And I guarantee you, once you hear him, you become so addicted that nobody else's voice can take his place. Don't you ever forget that you don't need a pulpit. You just need a message. Because once God calls you, no one can uncall you.